Robert Skidelsky, Russ Roberts, welcome.
Good to be here.
Good to be here and in this room, too.
Why good to be in this room?
Well, it's the IMF. It's the room which Keynes played a big part in setting up. He was co-founder of the IMF with Harry Dexter White.
Oh, it's good to have Keynes lurking over my shoulder. It's healthy.
Yeah, he'll keep you up to the mark.
Okay.
Give us the essence of Keynes, if you would, in your own words.
I think there are three main ideas. One is that the investment markets are volatile, and financial markets are volatile, and they can have they can swing much more than would be indicated by any efficient market theory.
Any standard economic theory.
That's right.
People know the future, they know what stocks are going to be worth, therefore they know what price to pay for the company now.
Yeah, I think the swings are much greater than you would expect if that set of theories were true. I think secondly, they're not automatically self-adjusting. They don't, after a shock, they don't swing right back to full employment. And therefore, full employment isn't continuous, but large-scale unemployment can develop. And the third idea is that there's nothing to stop that unemployment growing unless the government comes in with a stimulus to replace declining private spending by public spending. I think those are the three main ideas. He also had ideas about how to set up a system that would avoid this, but I think for the moment, those are the three most important.
So uncertainty with regard to the future, you stress in your book that that's the very essence of Keynes, yes?
Yes, I do. I think it infects or invades all parts of his theory. First of all, investment markets a lot of the knowledge on which they're based is precarious. And it isn't well-founded. Secondly, I think it also helps explain why economies shrink. It's because when something happens to shock them, people say, well, if people had adjusted immediately and their wages and prices adjusted immediately, the economy would not shrink. But they don't know what the correct wages and prices are in that process. And that gives time for output and employment to adjust rather than prices.
So in other words, the economy is shrinking, things are bad, uncertain. If I just took a lower wage, somebody at some point would hire me, we'd be back to me working, full employment.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think in an economics phrase, people don't know what the new equilibrium wage is.
They don't know what to charge.
No, you don't know what to charge. We don't have an auctioneer who, before trade starts, sort of actually finds the price at which buyers and sellers would come together. People are forced to trade as the economy is declining, and they don't know what the trade is. They don't know what the right price is.
For their labor or for anything they would buy.
Or for anything they'd buy or sell. That's absolutely right. And that's why output has a chance. It's got that space in which wages are being sticky to take the real brunt of the shock, and that's what Keynes said, and also the other thing why you need a fiscal stimulus rather than a monetary stimulus is the third area where uncertainty is important, because people don't know what the rate of interest is going to do, and therefore monetary policy might not get the boost in spending which fiscal policy can achieve.
Explain, if you would, what he means with regard to monetary policy and fiscal policy.
The idea of fiscal policy is government spending, often with borrowed money. In the current situation, that's what we're doing now.
And that's the stimulus.
That's the so-called stimulus. That's the fiscal policy. Sometimes it'll include tax policy. It might include cuts in tax rates, tax rebates. Monetary policy are the actions of the Federal Reserve in the United States, Bank of England in the UK, which would be changing the federal funds rate, which is one of the main mechanisms. But now, with that being very low in the United States, Chairman Bernanke is doing what is called quantitative easing. He is injecting money directly into the banks by buying assets of the banks and of other institutions. He's bought hundreds hundreds of billions of dollars of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac assets to push liquidity into the housing market, for example, and try to keep that market going.
Before we get to what they're doing now, I want to stay with Keynes for a minute, because
okay.
we haven't gotten to quantitative easing yet in his era.
We had, actually. It was one of the things he recommended.
Printing
money, quantitative easing.
Yeah, quantitative easing is just a central banker's euphemism for printing money and injecting it into the system directly when the lowering of interest rates has hit zero, yeah. Which is about where we are now. I think it's at about 0.25% is the goal for the federal funds rate.
That's the short-term interest rate.
That's the rate that banks charge each other for overnight lending. The Federal Reserve actually doesn't set that rate. What they actually do is they inject funds or extract funds to see, until that rate adjusts to their target goal. And they're good at that. So they do have a very decisive effect on the shortest of short-term rates. The short-term rates that banks charge each other, that in turn often will go through the rest of the economy. There's a debate in economics of whether they have any control over long-term rates. Some say yes, some say no. But they certainly have an impact on short-term rates. And when they can't affect the economy through that borrowing rate, especially if banks are uneasy about lending to each other or to anyone else, they're going to look for more direct ways, a la Milton Friedman, of injecting money into people's pockets, encouraging them to spend, and keeping the money supply and the banks and liquidity going, and avoiding the opposite, a collapse of the banking sector and a reduction in people's interest in spending.
And this is the famous, or relatively famous, Keynes idea of, hey, you could take bottles,
yeah.
put the dollars in the bottles.
Burying dollars or pounds in bottles and getting people to dig them up again.
Right,
yeah.
and people would inevitably do that, and you'd employ
yeah.
people thereby.
You'd employ people. I think Keynes's doubts about monetary policy, as just described, was the important thing in a slump is to get people to spend. And someone has to spend money. And the trouble is you can increase the amount of money, but you can't guarantee that it's spent. You can't guarantee that the long-term rates come down sufficiently. You can get the short rate down, but not the long-term rate. And even if you then argue, well, it makes people wealthier because people buy assets. If the price of price of bonds is going up and the price of securities may be going up, so people get wealthier, so that would increase their propensity to spend. That's an uncertain effect, and the more direct effect, well, you know, you're talking about an economy sliding. In the Great Depression, it slid for 12 successive quarters, and that's 3 years. And monetary policy is too uncertain. In Keynes's view, and therefore, when you're in a really deep depression, you actually have to have fiscal policy, the government has to spend money. It can print the money and spend it, that's fine, or it can borrow the money, and he thought you had to do both.
And so the essence of Keynes in that sense is we've got to make sure that people stay employed. The economy, because of uncertainty, has the propensity to occasionally contract and maybe stay contracted.
Yep.
With too many people unemployed. Therefore, whenever that happens, we've got to, as a government, spend the money to get the economy back up and moving.
Absolutely, and you don't wait until you've reached this low point before starting spending. You intervene in the downward slide by injecting extra aggregate demand into the economy.
Aggregate demand means just more spending
from
everybody.
Just more spending, yes, total spending, so as to stop the slide.
So spend money because an economy has the inclination to contract sometimes due to the fundamental uncertainty. Is that a fair rendering of the essence of Keynes?
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think it's right, but I think it's a fair rendering of Keynes and importantly how Keynes is interpreted today for policy purposes.
And by that you mean?
The justification for the stimulus that we're in the middle of in the United States, for example, and around the world, invokes the kind of arguments that Lord Skidelsky is using, that the economy without it will struggle and therefore it's necessary for the government to step in. That's a very common argument. And I think it's mistaken, but I think it's very much a Keynesian argument and people invoke Keynes all the time.